All right, thank you. It is my great pleasure to introduce Francis Oakley, who is Edward Dorr Griffin Professor of the History of Ideas Emeritus at Williams College, and also a past president of Williams, among many other prominent positions, both inside and outside academia, over the course of his distinguished career. Professor Oakley has published broadly on the history of medieval and early modern political thought. One of the main themes of his work, as the title of his talk today suggests, is kingship. In 2006, his book Kingship, The Politics of Enchantment was published. As luck would have it, I assigned a chapter of this book to my undergraduate class on medieval kingship 2 weeks ago, having set the syllabus long before I knew Professor Oakley was coming to campus. Not surprisingly, the chapter led to lively discussion, because as with so much of his work, this chapter on the long history of kingship strikes just the right balance between broad theoretical claims and concise, well-chosen examples and anecdotes. More recently, between the years 2010 and 2015, Professor Oakley also published a three-volume series with Yale University Press on the emergence of Western political thought in the Latin Middle Ages. And here again, the history of kingship is a central theme. I was fortunate to be in Boston this past winter when Professor Oakley was awarded the Haskins Medal from the Medieval Academy of America for these works. I quote briefly from the medal citation to give everyone here a sense of the praise these books have received. Quote, "The trilogy dazzlingly substantiates a simple thesis. The secular nature of modern political thought emerged not from ancient Greece and Rome, but from the Latin Middle Ages. Deeply learned, engagingly written, encyclopedic, and wise, the emergence of Western political thought is already regarded as a monument in the history of ideas, a masterful explication of the interplay among religion, politics, and education in the West." Close quote. I have to admit to being a bit biased as a medievalist, but as far as I'm concerned, any scholar who argues as eloquently as Professor Oakley does in these volumes that the Latin Middle Ages, not classical civilization, is the true seedbed, the true intellectual seedbed of the West, as he calls it, is always welcome at the University of Chicago. So please join me in welcoming Professor Oakley, who will be speaking today on Kingship, the Politics of Enchantment.
I fully realize that you may well regard my choice of topic this evening as a bit quixotic. I can try to explain it. The person responsible is sitting just here, is Constantine Fazold, who, as the editor of a series for Blackwell's Publishing, asked me to take on, I think we kicked around a couple of things. I wanted to do this because I thought it would be a good warm-up exercise on a global front for the three volumes I was contemplating, and which took me about 12 years to do. That doesn't make it less quixotic. After all, if we exclude from our purview those contemporary African kings, whose titles, however revered, no longer confer upon them any formal political role or standing, and who are in effect private citizens of the respective nations. And if we limit the focus to the 191 states around the globe, whose independent standing has been recognized by extension to them of membership in the United Nations, if we do that, we'll find that only a handful today possess monarchical regimes of any sort. Most of those are, of course, constitutional monarchs, reigning rather than ruling, serving as essentially formal heads of state charged with representing their countries abroad and with the performance of purely ceremonial duties. Regimes in the bulk of the freestanding states of the early 21st century range instead from non-monarchical but authoritarian via the non-democratic but still quasi-constitutionalist, all the way to the liberal democratic forms pioneered in North America and Western Europe. And if one aspired to identify the constitutional wave of the future, kingship would hardly come to mind, whereas one might be able to make a reasonably persuasive case for democracy. It's true that as recently as 1970, there were probably no more than 30 democratic regimes worldwide. By now, that's probably roughly quadrupled. So as a result, we've become accustomed to encountering in the press and in the pronouncements of some of our politicians the casual attribution of something approaching a manifest destiny to forms of liberal democracy that have triumphed in Western Europe, North America, and elsewhere. But if our ears occasionally ring to the clamor of voices in high places calling for the transplanting of democratic ideals in new and sometimes improbable settings across the world, we do well, I think, to bring to the evaluation of such calls the hard-won measure of perspective afforded by two things. First, the tragic history of the past century. Second, the longer course of world history. It's with the second idea thing that I'll be concerned this evening. But just a word in passing about the first. Surely it's too soon to put out of mind the harsh lessons to be learned from the apocalyptic rigors of 20th century political life, especially in old European countries that had long since logged in considerable mileage with liberal democratic institutions. At the start of the 20th century, it was easy enough for progressive historians, if I'm permitted to use that term, it was easy enough for them to take for granted that the established course of the history would continue to move the world naturally towards the realization of a governmental norm that would be essentially constitutionalist and involve the routine limitation of executive power by institutional means short of force. To their more chastened successes at the end of that 20th century, however, that degree of confidence was no longer available. The flowering in the first half of the century in the very heartland of Europe of totalitarian despotisms of the most squalid kind, and the more recent challenges confronted by countries in the developing world, as well as in Latin America and Eastern Central Europe, as they attempted to create the institutions and practices of a viable civil society. Such bracing realities hardly encourage one to take at all for granted the flowering on the world historical scene of constitutionalism itself, let alone the growth of that more exotic plant that we call liberal democracy. Moreover, and turning now in the second place to the world historical record, I'm almost embarrassed to use terms like that, but that's what I'm going to do. Let me draw to your attention that in one of the eloquent speeches that punctuated his public career, Adlai Stevenson once proclaimed that the natural government of man is servitude. Tyranny is the normal pattern of human government. It would doubtless be possible to give him a bit of an argument on that score, but you know, had he used the word kingship instead of tyranny, he would have left little room for reasonable dissent. We're accustomed, it's true, to make much of the brief era of the Greek polis in the 5th and 4th centuries before the Common Era, or of the Republican centuries at Rome preceding the dawn of that Common Era, or sometimes even of the brief late medieval flowering of quasi-republican institutions in the North Italian city-states. But you know, these amounted to no more than what have been called republican parentheses, fleeting episodes, beleaguered islands lapped by the waves of an engulfing monarchical see. So far as what we're accustomed to calling the political is concerned, and if we boldly take as our purview the whole global history of humankind, we really have to recognize one simple, fundamental, but commonly overlooked fact. What is it? Nothing other than this, that in terms of its antiquity, its quasi-ubiquity, its wholly extraordinary powers of endurance, it's the institution of kingship that stands out as the most common form of government known to humankind. Of similar millennial endurance has been the related set of ideological patterns that in one version or another, and for long millennia, sustained that monarchical institution. In terms certainly of its ubiquity and longevity, that ideology can lay strong claim to having been nothing other than the political common sense of humankind. And like the institution of kingship itself, that common sense turns out to have been deeply embedded in the sacred. For the kings are sacred, it's well been said, is an anthropological and historical truism. I will realize these are huge claims, and though I've written extensively and probably tiresomely in their support, time permits me this evening to illustrate and support them only in the most telegraphic of fashions, but not to complain, just to plow on that. As follows, so far as the global reach and millennial endurance of kingship goes, when by the start of the third millennium before the Common Era, with the invention of writing, the occluding historiographic mists begin for us finally to disperse, we find that kingship had long since begun to establish itself in the ancient Near East. It had done so along the Nile Valley in Egypt and the Tigris and Euphrates basin in Mesopotamia, as well as in the flatlands that stretched between them. And it was to leave its imprint also on the modes of rulership characteristic elsewhere in the ancient Near East and in the lands bordering on the Syrian, Canaanite, and Minoan kingship of the mid-third to mid-second century millennia before the Common Era, as well as on types of kingships to be found in Crete and Greece during the Mycenaean era in the second millennium, in the realms of Israel and Judah during the first half of the following millennium, and in the great Persian Empire that rose to a position of Near Eastern hegemony between the 6th and 4th centuries before the Common Era. By the Mycenaean era, altogether independently, and at the other end of the world, kingship had already made an appearance and was destined to attain its classic form almost a millennium later during the Qin and Han periods from about the 2nd century before the Common Era to the 3rd century or 4th century afterwards. The following century witnessed the appearance of consolidation also in Central Asia, Japan, and Korea, as well as in South and Southeast Asia and Polynesia, in most of which regions kingship was destined to persist down into the 19th and even 20th centuries. That was to be true also of the kingship in the West. There in Western, Central, and Eastern Europe, Christian kings had emerged during the early medieval centuries, successors alike of the Roman emperors and of the Celtic and Germanic kings of the pre-Christian past. And a similar longevity was to be enjoyed by the forms of kingship that rose to prominence across the vast reaches of the Muslim world. Meanwhile, on the other side of the Atlantic, during the centuries labeled in Eurocentric historiography as late antique, medieval, early modern, the lands of Mesoamerica and South America, witnessed the wholly independent emergence of the Olmec, Maya, Toltec, Aztec, and Inca monarchies. Similarly, in sub-Saharan Africa, the medieval and subsequent centuries down to the 20th were punctuated by the rise, persistence, or fall of a myriad of kingdoms, great and small, from that of the Shilluk in the north to Swaziland, still extant, in the south, or those of Benin, Cuba, and Yorubaland in the west, to those that flourished in Tanzania and Uganda in the east. Now, that's a mind-numbing list, I suppose, but don't worry, there's no quiz. And it would be easy as one goes through a list like that to miss the fact that there's something really extraordinary about it. The trouble about history, the late Hugh Trevor Roper once insisted, is that we take it too much for granted. By our earnest explanations and interpretations, in effect, we contrive to flatten the course of history, to reduce it to the routine and the predictable, and by so doing, we deprive it of the wonder that should properly belong to it. Certainly, we should not take for granted the ubiquity and longevity of the institution of sacral kingship in all its various forms and guises. Still less should we take for granted the fact that it has been persistently nourished by a form of what one might call, for shorthand purposes, the cosmic religiosity. Of course, the cartography of the mind is an endeavor fraught inevitably with challenge, the more so when the mind in question is so frustratingly remote from ours today. Not necessarily remote in time, though I'll be using terms like archaic and pre-modern, I have to use something, for variants of that cosmic religiosity and the sort of sacral kingship it sustained persisted in parts of the world down into the 19th and 20th centuries. Remote instead in its distance from the modalities of thought long since habitual to those of us nurtured, intellectually speaking, in the disenchanted cradle of westernizing modernity. In contrast with those modalities of thought, the archaic mentality seems characteristically to have attempted to penetrate the encompassing mystery of being along an essentially symbolic, analogical, or associational, rather than a strictly causal axis of explanation. Actors in what has been called an ongoing drama of being, and participants as they seem to have intuited themselves to be, in a richly variegated community that reached out beyond humankind to encompass the world of nature and its countless denizens, as well as the more enduring realm of the divine. Doing that, the people of archaic or pre-modern societies appear instinctively to have been moved by the explanatory power of symbol and analogy. The mainspring of the acts, thoughts, and feelings of early man was the conviction that the divine was immanent in nature, and nature intimately connected with society. The mentality involved was thoroughly monistic. The sharp distinctions we are accustomed to making between nature and supernature, between nature, society, and man, between animate and inanimate, were almost wholly lacking. In the significant moments of his life, it has well been said, archaic man was confronted not by an inanimate and impersonal nature, not by an it, but by a thou. Nature was alive. It was, as the ancient expressions go, full of gods or full of Jupiter. It expressed both in its benign cyclic rhythms, and in its intimidating and catastrophic upheavals, the movements and indwelling of the divine. Hardly surprising, then, that man himself should be conceived less as an individual standing ultimately alone than as an integral part of society, deriving therefrom whatever value he possessed. Hardly surprising either that society itself should be considered as embedded in nature in some profoundly mysterious way, as entangled intimately with the processes of the natural world. Hardly surprising again that society's primary function should be something seen to exceed the powers of any normal individual, namely the preservation of the cosmic order by a complex system of ritual and taboo, the prevention of natural catastrophes, the seasonal regeneration of the world via the ritual celebration of New Year festivals, and the harmonious integration of humankind with nature. That is to say, nature being itself a manifestation of the divine, it's hardly surprising that the primary function of society, family, the tribe, ultimately the royal rulers, the first object of its conscious daily solicitude should be what we, again, would call the religious. So at the heart of archaic politics, then, lay one form or another of the cosmic religion, so much so, indeed, that for the greater part of human history, it's an egregious anachronism even to make use of those words religion and political, the very definitions of which tend to assume our modern Western distinction between the religious and the political, and evoke misleadingly the intimations of modern church-state dialectic. This becomes evident once one takes the trouble to examine archaic concepts of kingship, which was conceived in China and Mesoamerica, no less than in the ancient Near East and elsewhere, as an institution, in a sense, anchored in the cosmos. If we refer to kingship as a political institution, Henri Frankfurt has said some time ago, we assume a point of view which would have been incomprehensible to the ancients. We imply that the human polity can be considered in itself. The ancients, however, experienced human life as part of a widely spreading network of connections which reached beyond the local and national communities into the hidden depths of nature, the purely secular, insofar as it could be granted to exist at all, was the purely trivial. Whatever was significant was embedded in the life of the cosmos, and it was precisely the king's function to maintain the harmony of that integration. Frankfurt speaking there with explicit reference to the ancient Near East, but his formulation is particularly valuable because it could refer not only to the state of affairs in ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia, but also, its rich variety notwithstanding, to the fundamentally sacred nature of kingship worldwide, and to the depths of its rootage in that cosmic religiosity. Despite the successive geologic deposits of Taoist, Confucian, and Buddhist patterns of thought, it's the Chinese Empire, indeed, that proved to be the most stable and enduring manifestation of that phenomenon. For 2 millennia and more, and in this independent of analogous developments elsewhere in Eurasia and Mesoamerica, it remained the emperor's duty as son of heaven and possessor of the mysterious mandate of heaven to bridge the gulf between heaven and earth, and by scrupulously performing a cyclic round of rituals and sacrifices geared to significant calendric moments, to secure the maintenance of order, cosmic, no less than mundane, natural, no less than societal. The structures of the altars of earth and heaven and to the north and south of the imperial palace at Beijing, at which until 1912 the emperor offered sacrifice on the occasion of the summer and winter solstices, respectively, was meant to indicate the cosmic totality at the center of which the emperor dwells as the all-commanding axis on which both the order of the universe and that of society and the state depend. What was involved, in effect, was a form of religiosity typical of which was the symbolization of our familiar profane space and time via the analogy of the all-embracing spatial and temporal order of the cosmos itself, to which it was characteristically related as microcosm to macrocosm, to that cosmic order, to the repetitive movements of the heavenly bodies and the cyclic rhythms of vegetative nature, the forms, laws, and procedures of terrestrial political society were then analogized. And here I can't help thinking of the similar analogies which Plato drew in his great cosmological dialogue, The Timaeus. And I can't help thinking accordingly also of Mircea Eliade's perceptive characterization of Plato as the outstanding philosopher of primitive mentality. That is, the thinker who succeeded in giving philosophical currency and validity to the modes of life and behavior of archaic humanity. So far indeed as mundane objects in the external world and human actions were concerned, they were understood as deriving whatever value they possessed from the participation in the archetypes, celestial archetypes and forms of reality that transcended them. This was quintessentially the case with such terrestrial structures as temples, royal palaces, cities even, which were regarded as having been fashioned on the model of cosmic or celestial archetypes. One example of this may well be, although the evidence is tangled, the great temple oriented to the east and the rising sun, which Solomon, with the help of Phoenician architects, erected at the cultic center of Jerusalem. So constituted, such temples were often assimilated, ideologically speaking, to the cosmic mountain that was understood to have emerged from the primordial waters at the moment when the god or gods had rescued cosmic order from chaos. They were understood, moreover, to be situated at the very axis mundi, the hub, center, or navel of the world, the numinous intersection of heaven and earth, and the point of contact with the gods. In Mesoamerican Mayan terms, it was the portal of the other world. In Mesopotamian terms, the gate of the gods. That, after all, is what the word Babylon, Babylani, means. And the ziggurats of Mesopotamia, no less than the pyramids, platforms, temples, and high places of Egypt, Mesoamerica, and parts of Africa, symbolized the primal cosmic mountain. In the Maya kingdoms, each temple was centered on the axis mundi, or hub of the world tree, which the divine father had used at the creation to lift the sky up over the earth, and which constituted the numinous point of contact with the divine, the conduit between the celestial overworld, the earthly middle world, and Xibalba, the underworld ruled over by the dark lords of death. Can't help thinking in relation to that of Yggdrasil, the world tree of Scandinavian mythology, which had a very similar function, supporting the heavens with its branches and being the conduit down to the world of men, below that to the world of the dead. It would be possible, and at unconscionable length, to illustrate with examples drawn from all over the world the Baroque complexities of the ideological formations constructed around what seems to have been a universal core of fundamental religio-political commitments, the ones I've just touched upon. I won't even try to do that. I simply hope that I've said enough, maybe too much, but enough to convey a clear sense that the age-old tradition of sacral kingship and the ideology that characterized it were such as to be profoundly at odds with the fundamental commitments common to all three of the Abrahamic religions. Not least among those commitments, the understanding of God as transcendent and omnipotent, set over against the world, as Kierkegaard put it, by an infinite qualitative difference, and lacking therefore any sort of consubstantiality with the world of nature. That world was understood instead as having been brought into being not by a merely demiurgic imposition of cosmic order on some pre-existing chaos, but by a simple, untrammeled exercise of divine will. And that act of creation came eventually to be understood, to the great amusement of the Greek philosophers, as a creation out of nothing. To the philosophers, a sheer nonsense, of course. Out of nothing, nothing comes, was the reply. That world then was a disenchanted one, and the divine having been drained out of nature, one would have thought that the very institution of sacral kingship, charged as it was with the responsibility of harmonizing human society with the natural world, a natural world infused with the divine, one would have thought that that very institution would have been called frontally into question. Astonishingly, that didn't quite happen, either in the Judaic and Islamic worlds or in Christendom. And that it didn't happen should underline for us the sheer power of the empire that age-old notions of sacral kingship had come to exercise over the human imagination and the human psyche. So that despite their encounter with religious commitments with which they were fundamentally at odds, such notions, though modified in form, were to survive for long centuries. They did so in the Christian world right down, I would argue, to the era of the French Revolution, when, as Sergio Bertelli has put it, in the 3 minutes that it took Louis XVI in 1793 to descend the steps of his carriage and move to meet his death under the blade of the guillotine, in those 3 minutes, he says, 1,000 years of the religio regis, the religion of the king, came to an end. I'd say more than 1,000 years, but we won't argue with him here. Now, astonishing though it was, that persistence of royal sacrality, involving as it did some very complex accommodations, was not unmarked by stresses and strains and recurrent moments of tension between stubborn remnants of the old cosmic religiosity and the vastly different commitments characteristic of all three of the Abrahamic religions. Moments, in effect, of what I called in one of my books, Abrahamic unease. Thus, the fundamental uneasiness attendant upon the position of the Hebrew kings, signaled, for example, by the presence of two very different accounts and attitudes, accounts of the kingship and attitudes towards it, evident in those parts of the books of Samuel concerned with the establishment of the kingship in Israel. On the one hand, Yahweh is depicted as having recognized the need for kingship, as having accepted the popular desire for it, and what amounted to a sort of beneficent divine gift, as having anointed Saul as king. On the other, however, elsewhere in those books, he's portrayed, he, Yahweh, as having regarded the demand of the Israelites to have, like other nations, a king to govern them, as being nothing less than a quasi-blasphemous betrayal, derogating from his own supreme and eternal kingship. Again and again, moreover, prophetic voices were to be raised defending that true kingship against those deluded human upstarts, monarchs who, worshipping at the high places of the old nature gods, sought to raise their thrones on high, to make themselves like the Most High. Thus Isaiah, "They made kings," said the Lord to Hosea, "but not through me. They set up princes, but without my knowledge." Similar sentiments, antipathetic to archaic notions of sacral kingship, have surfaced down through the centuries from time to time among the Muslim ulama, religious teachers. That sort of uneasiness or upset expressed most strikingly of recent years by the Ayatollah Khomeini himself, when at Persepolis in 1971, the Shah of Iran, Shahan Shah, King of Kings, unwisely made a point of lauding the virtues of 2,500 years of Persian kingship, Khomeini, his future nemesis, tartly responded from rancorous exile in Paris by attacking as un-Islamic the very title of King of Kings. And in so doing, he was echoing the early Muslim juristic view that that particular title represented a profane human usurpation of a prerogative that belonged to God alone. "The title King of Kings," he said, "is the most hated of all titles in the sight of God." And then he went on, stretching the case a bit, to insist that monarchy was totally alien to Islam. That's a difficult historic case to make, but he wasn't making a historic case. So neither in the Byzantine East nor in the Latin West was hostility of this sort, or even worried ambivalence towards sacralized forms of kingship, quite as salient. It wasn't totally absent, it wasn't as salient. And that despite the bleakly negative and fundamentally secular understanding of Roman imperial power, evidenced by the mature Augustine in the pages of the City of God. The younger Augustine didn't feel that way, but the mature Augustine did, and it's clear in the pages of that great book. In the Byzantine East, indeed, there came to prevail a sort of theopolitical vision of Christian empire that had its roots in the sacralized Hellenistic philosophy of kingship, embraced in the first century of the Christian era, of the Common Era, by Philo of Alexandria, later extended somewhat by the Alexandrine Church Fathers, and in the fourth century of the Christian era, with what was viewed as the providentially ordained embrace of Christian belief by the Emperor Constantine, it was given mature and influential expression by Eusebius of Caesarea. What Eusebius engineered was the precarious insertion of some of the essentially atemporal notions associated with the archaic sacral kingship and its sustaining cosmic religiosity into the ineluctably historical modality of thinking that stemmed from the Bible. Thus, the newly Christianized empire was represented as a providential manifestation of the dawning kingdom of God, and inserted, as it were, into the unfolding narrative of salvation history, The imperial government was apprehended as some sort of terrestrial image of the rule of God in heaven, and a burly Christianized version of the old imperial ruler cult was to remain for centuries embedded in the elaborate ceremonial of the imperial court. The emperor, it became common to portray as a new David, a new Solomon, a veritable successor of Melchizedek, the archetypal priest-king of the Old Testament. He was seen, therefore, as a priestly figure, possessed of truly governmental authority over the church. The Emperor Justinian's legislation, accordingly and quintessentially, was to extend to almost every nook and cranny of ecclesiastical life. As he himself put it in one of his decrees, it was his conviction that the priesthood and the imperium do not differ in very much, nor are sacred things so very different from those of public and common interest. The important authority, indeed, the imperial authority, indeed, he viewed, of course, as a gift of God to men, and he believed it to be a fundamental part of his imperial mission to lead his people to God. The very structures of church and empire had come close to coalescing, and the Christian society thus produced was seen as standing by its very existence in close proximity to the kingdom of God. Now, while in its totality that Eusebian political theology, so dominant in the Byzantine East, and maybe, although it's hotly argued, handed on in part to Russia, Imperial Russia, wasn't destined to enjoy much of a career in the Latin West, but some bits and pieces of its providential optimism were mediated to the Latin future by the popular 5th century Spanish author Orosius, thus stressing in the manner of Luke's Gospel and Acts the coincidence between the birth of Christ and Caesar Augustus's vindication of a monarchy that was truly universal. He had set out to demonstrate that, I quote, in every respect, the empire of Augustus had been prepared for the advent of Christ. But though Orosius was widely read in the Middle Ages, the type of accommodation with archaic notions of royal sacrality arrived at during the Carolingian era, the 8th century largely, and developed further in the 10th and 11th centuries under the Ottonian and Salian emperors, was rather more reflective of Old Testament and related liturgical themes. During the late antique and early medieval centuries, as overt paganism died out or was suppressed, membership what we would call the church and membership in what we might call the state moved steadily closer to being coterminous. Under the rule of Charlemagne in the 8th and 9th centuries, the several micro-Christendoms of Western Europe were finally fused into a single Latin Christendom, a single public society, empire, Christian, commonwealth, call what you will. Already by the early 8th century, developing church practice in its intermingling of the civil and ecclesiastical, and especially in the authority so readily conceded to kings in matters religious, it reflected a considerable degree of accommodation with the pagan sacral kingship of old. It was simply left for the clerical shapers of opinion in the Carolingian era to exploit the Bible and patristic materials available to them in a reasonably successful attempt to make some sort of theological peace with that state of affairs. The legacy, as a result, was a theoretical framework within which the theocratic form of Christian kingship that emerged in the course of the 8th century as the dominant religio-political institution in Europe was able for the next three centuries and more to flourish. And it was, interestingly, above all, the cultus of biblical kingship that provided the ideological underpinnings for this early medieval form of sacred kingship. And it continued for long centuries to impart a very distinctive tonality to the royal institution. Accordingly and ironically, it was the Bible itself, as Mark Bloch once put it, that provided in the West the means of reintroducing into the lawful ceremonies of Christianity the sacred royalty of past ages. And in all of this, the ceremony of unction or anointing, the ancient Near Eastern rite for the transfer of someone from the sphere of the profane into that of the sacred, that played a crucial role. Adopted by the Israelites for the inauguration of their own kings, and in the Christian world already folded into the ceremonial associated with baptism, confirmation, and the ordination of priests, and later the consecration of bishops, it became in the 8th century part of the ceremonial inauguration of the Frankish kings, and gradually spread thence to converge in the end in a liturgical form that was truly international in character, the liturgical form used in 1937, or used in 1953, I should say, for the inauguration of Queen Elizabeth II, raising complaints in the newspapers about the sacerdotalization of the monarchy. And it's going to be very interesting to see what happens next time around. I suspect there'll be furrowed brows in the cabinet arguing about what's to be done, as there were in Japan, the last coronation rites, where Christians and the communists, interestingly, in alliance, complained about the expenditure of government monies on one of the central inaugural ceremonies for the Japanese emperor. It was sort of sounds like it was all a very hush-hush sort of thing that goes on when he communes with the nature god, the rice god. It's a sort of fertility rite, I think. But anyway, the liturgical ordo used for the coronation and anointing of Elizabeth II was known as the Edgar Ordo, dating to 973. So, certain continuity there. The papacy, moreover, linked the anointing of the Frankish kings with the peculiar destiny of the Frankish nation as a whole. The Franks were called the new sacred people of promise. And as Ernst Kantarovich once put it, they contrived to wheel into church history as the continuators of Israel's exploits, rather than into Roman history as the heirs of pagan Rome. Along with the royal anointing went the proclivity for seeing the position and attributes of the Frankish monarchs as closely paralleling the sacred position and priestly attributes of the Old Testament kings, and for associating them, of course, with such figures as David, Solomon, Melchizedek, the archetypal priest king. Hardly surprising, then, that they grew up around the Carolingian rulers, or their analogues in more than one part of Europe, what amounted to a reworked version of the archaic ruler cult, with the laudes regiae, or liturgical acclamations of the ruler, replicating the acclamations once tendered to the pagan Roman emperors, and constituting a medieval equivalent of ancient ruler worship. Hardly surprising either that with time, the essentially theocratic form of kingship involved came eventually to be clericalized, with the ceremony of royal anointing, which was viewed as a sacrament, seen as removing the king or emperor from the ranks of the laity and making him some sort of participant in the priestly ministry itself. Nor is it surprising that in the 11th century, the kingship of the German emperors, who now deployed the title of Vicars of Christ, came to be seen as not simply theocratic, but more specifically Christocentric, for it was said, priests and kings are both Christ's, i.e. anointed ones. The priest imaging Christ's lower and human nature and office, the king his higher and divine office and nature. And that being so, and Christ's divinity being higher than his humanity, so too was his royal power seen as superior to his priestly power. As a result, surely, there was nothing unjust in the priestly dignity being instituted by the regal, by the king, and subordinated to it. Or so argued a chap around 1100, we know only as the anonymous, Anglo-Norman Anonymous. He wrote extensively on this sort of thing. But by that time, 1100, the Gregorian church reformers, contesting the long-established claim of the German emperors to exercise authority even in matters religious, had come boldly to proclaim that the age of priest kings and emperor pontiffs is now over, and to insist that the Emperor Henry IV was, I quote, neither monk or cleric, just a layman, nothing more. They didn't immediately succeed in making that oppositional effort stick. And in the later medieval and early modern period, there was in fact a sort of intensification in the attachment of a sacred aura to kings. As late as survived the Reformation, as late as the 1660s, Charles II of England, of all people, was to exercise his curative powers, such powers being attributed to English and French kings by virtue of the sacrament of royal anointing. He exercised those powers by touching to cure, in the first 4 years of his reign, some 20,000 sufferers from the scrofula-related diseases that had come to be known as the king's evil. You can work out day by day, he was extremely busy doing that, because he didn't want to go on his travels, so he needed whatever form of legitimation he could lay his hands on. But it's quite remarkable, 20,000. But intriguing, but I can't dwell on it all. Instead, I want to use the ends in sight, my remaining time, to focus on something else that I view as highly significant and truly curious. It's a turn in things whereby the papacy, despite its onslaught on the sacral aura of the 11th century kings, came itself to be drawn into the ideological orbit described by sacral kingship. For that development has its pertinence, I think, to what I'll be talking about tomorrow, although I won't say much about it, but it's pertinent to it. Earlier claims notwithstanding, the papacy and over the modern period is essentially a product of, of the modern period exercising monarchical powers over the entire Roman Catholic Church worldwide. It's very much the product of the second 1,000 years of church history, and in terms of its actual operation, very much the product of the last 200 years, in fact, since the French Revolution. After all, of the 25 popes who reigned between 955 and 1057, no fewer than 12 were appointed by those other vicars of Christ, the German emperors, who were also responsible for ejecting 5 of the 25 from their high office. The great turning point for all of this, of course, was the Gregorian reform of the late 11th century, marked as it was by a frontal assault on sacral kingship and by an attempt to de-clericalize the imperial office. Revolutionary claims were advanced to the effect that the priests of Christ are to be considered as the fathers and mothers of kings and princes and of all believers, that the Pope might absolve subjects of unjust men from their fealty, that he might even indeed depose emperors. and by twice acting on that last claim and twice deposing the Emperor Henry IV, Gregory set the medieval papacy on its quest for monarchical supremacy. Supremacy within the hierarchical ecclesiastical order itself, where the high medieval popes laid claims to a sweeping fullness of jurisdiction, i.e. governmental power, the plenitude of power, and also beyond that, supremacy also in the temporal sphere and the Christian world at large. That's an old, well-known story. But what I wouldn't want you to miss, it's not to be taken for granted, is the fact that despite the Gregorian attempt to deprive kings and emperors of the age-old sacral aura, the high medieval popes were to succumb to the lure of sacral kingship and to permit themselves to emerge as fully fledged sacred monarchs in their own right, formally crowned with the triple crown from the mid-11th century down to the mid-1960s, when Paul VI finally consigned the triple crown and other monarchical trappings to museum status. Not only crowned, but enmantled with the red imperial cope or capa rubea, using the imperial regalia of Rome, presenting themselves in effect as the true successors of Constantine, this Boniface VIII, 1298 or so the chronicler tells us, and he doesn't seem to think we'd automatically disbelieve him, received the ambassador of Albert of Habsburg as claimant to the imperial throne in the following fashion. Sitting on a throne, wearing on his head the diadem of Constantine, his right hand on the hilt of the sword with which he was girt, he, the Pope, cried out, "Am I not the supreme pontiff?" Roman pagan title. Am I not the supreme pontiff? Is this throne not the pulpit of Peter? Is it not my duty to watch over the rights of the empire? It is I who am Caesar. It is I who am emperor. Now, it's true that his great predecessors, Innocent III and Innocent IV, tended in their practical judgments to be a good deal more loyally and responsive to the nuance and complexity of law. But even they do appear to have been advocates of what amounted to a papal theocracy. Christ, said Innocent IV, being himself true king and true priest after the order of Melchizedek, established not only a pontifical, but a royal monarchy in the apostolic see. So the 13th century of popes emerged as regal figures, appropriating the old pagan imperial title of supreme pontiff, being referred to as true emperors, celestial emperors, living law, taking upon themselves the attributes and legal prerogatives of the erstwhile Roman emperors, and becoming the focus of ceremonial observances and symbolic gestures of the type attaching for so long to the sacral kings of yesteryear. And for all of this, James of Viterbo, not a household name, I realize, but a significant figure, writing in 1302 a tract that's been called the most ancient treatise on the church. I think that's accurate, too. A tract called De Regimine Christiano. He provided the theological foundation for all of this, for he systematically treated the church militant as itself a kingdom, the regnum ecclesiae, the kingdom of Christ. Kingdom of Christ it may be, but also the kingdom of the Pope, his vicar, who is truly called, so James said, and is a king. Indeed, beyond that, he was a veritable king of kings. I don't know what Khomeini would have said about that, but that's what James said. So what to conclude? Well, if I could jump forward to the 17th century, when the ideological dust kicked up by centuries of intermittent strife between popes, emperors, and kings had finally begun to settle. Let me note that in a celebrated aside, the great English philosopher Thomas Hobbes was to describe the papacy, I quote, as no other than the ghost of the deceased Roman Empire sitting crowned on the grave thereof. Now, in light of the high medieval developments I've been describing, it's now time, I believe, to concede that Hobbes's observation is really no less illuminating in its fundamental perception for being derisive in its conscious intent, and it was derisive in its conscious intent. Thank you very much for your patience.